everyone. I am Shruti and I am going to be your host for today for the sixth episode of our podcast series, an initiative by Alumni Relations Team. Aligning ourselves with the name of our college, we finally have an HR on our podcast. Today, we are going to talk in depth about talent acquisition, and it is a matter of immense privilege to talk to Mr. Samsundar Palaparthi, who has around 9 years of experience in this domain and is currently working as a talent acquisition lead India at BASF. Hello, Sam. Welcome to our podcast.
Hi, Shruti. Pleasure is always mine.
Okay. So to begin with, I really want to know, you have worked in Citibank as well as you're working currently in BASF. Both are very different organizations in their respective domains. So can you give us a view on the contrast on these both roles and what are the common threads and links between these two?
Okay, great. So the baseline I will kind of set maybe today for our conversation is I'm not going to promote any organization or demean any organization. It's purely from an academic point that we will talk about these organizations or culturally when we talk about any organization.
Yes.
So very high regards for both BASF and Citi. It's been wonderful working with both of them. But yes, they are culturally very different. One is a European company. One is an American organization. The Americans traditionally, have a lot of emphasis on speed of delivery, right? Whereas the Europeans, ones in my limited experience that I've had with both these cultures, are more into planning and, execution. So the speed at which we deliver, the Europeans envy the Americans. We have a lot of, emphasis to speed up our delivery. But culturally, if you see a European company is more into planning. So why, what, when, where, how, the theory of doing things. Whereas in the other sphere, yes, these are equally important, but the more emphasis is on delivery, right? So at the end of the day, there is a job at hand, you need to deliver. The common threads, I think both, at least the organizations that I worked in the HR sphere, one priority is very clear, which is employee experience. So you do it, with your right hand or left hand. At the end of the day, employees matter. And I think even common culture between both of them is that it's beyond, just bringing in cakes or being a typical tick mark function, right? That you see an HR guy during appraisal cycle, or you see them during some festivities or rangolis, the traditional HR so-called, in inverted quotes. So employee experience matters, and taking tough calls, be it for the employee or for the organization, being in a position to have scientific backing to the decision you're taking. It's not an arbitrary decision that you're taking. And you have some amount of science to the entire development. And I think that's very strongly emphasized, and that's where your education and your pedigree kind of comes to a backing.
Okay. Okay, so we get it. We get the difference. Nice. Okay. So you know that we experience a year of massive changes, and a lot of companies have done great job in implementing and especially adapting to new methods. So can you tell us what are the changes you have observed over all these years of your working experience in a specific domain, that is talent acquisition?
Got it. So fairly to tell, ever since I started my career with BASF and when I moved with Citi, both were very mature on the digital space, right? The level of maturity is significantly higher as compared to the standard organizations. Now it's up to the managers to implement, or the staff to implement, the tools that are there at your disposal. During COVID, I think the adoption went high. Certain managers who otherwise being old school would prefer to see a candidate face to face, now are, they don't have a choice, right? So it's not that they can still prefer, but they are much more open right now. And I think the positive side of a pandemic is pushing digitization upwards. While we have invested, I think the utility of it can clearly be seen. One of the key developments in talent acquisition, which is very spoken about, is implementation of AI and machine learning in recruitment, talent acquisition space.
Yes.
I kind of look at that, but I would also want to take it with a tinge of salt because I am a firm believer technology is an enabler, it is not a replacer, right? So at the
Right.
end of the day, there will be a person with a brain sitting behind and he will have to put in an effort. My concern kind of comes in when that person says, I can let technology take over. Example, you have these CV screening tools and everything, but there's no standard way of writing a CV, right? So
Right,
the
correct.
same role can be described in 10 different ways, and letting a machine do the sorting. Maybe, yeah, if you're working in, say, for example, you're recruiting for a generic role where you have 8,000, 9,000 applicants, humanly not possible
Right.
to go through them. But maybe can you use
Right.
a tool to look at the top 50 CVs, right? At least sort it for the recruiter to see. That's where technology adds value. But if someone is expecting that, you know, I will run this tool and they will give me the top three candidates and I'll interview them and select, then that is entering into a very dangerous area. You might get the top
Correct.
CV, but are those the correct fit? What about those who have much more advanced CV writing skills? Or maybe you have not configured your tool to look certain languages, or linguistic settings. So
Right.
while in the pandemic, these kind of things are very highly spoken of, I think we all have to be mature in taking baby steps in these. The adoption, yes, I think there is a keen interest, both from the organization's perspective and even from candidates. I think now people are much more open to, doing digital interviews. Otherwise, they always felt
Yes.
that doing digitally, you don't put your best foot forward, right? So you will say
Right,
that
right.
the manager can't see me, they can't see my body language.
Yeah.
Am I giving my
Right.
100%? So it works both ways. But I think overall, the adoption is much more open right now.
Okay. So do you think these technological advancements have accelerated so much in pandemic? So maybe 10 years down the line, do you think these screening processes will get automated?
As I said, so from my experience and seeing these fields much closer, you can't negate the role of a recruiter, right? And I'll give you a
Right.
simple example. Where can you implement technology for streamlining your pipelines when you have low
Correct.
value roles and you're looking in quantity, right? So say for
Right.
example, you're looking at a sales and marketing guy in a typical
Correct.
FMCG, right? You might have a requirement of 200, 300 people when you do a recruitment drive for pan across the country. There you can look at it. Or rather, let's take another example, telemarketer, right? So it's a role that requires you to sit behind the desk. You can implement tools
Right.
to, kind of finalize these. But what we are also seeing,
Right.
digitization is not only restricted to talent acquisition, it is also in the business. So in future,
Correct.
what will also happen is these kind of telemarketer roles also will get digitized. There are high-end technology solutions that will come which will do or enable the work of 10 people for one person to do, right? So
Right,
from what
right.
we observe is that in future, you will go into an area where you will do fewer number of recruitments, but each hiring is going to be complex. You most
Got it.
probably might not get into volume recruiting. And if you're getting into
Correct.
volume recruiting, there you already have enough tools in place where you can't even call it recruiting tools. Those are basic tools, right? So the moment you click
Correct,
on
correct.
apply, the system might even tell you that you match, you don't match. Say, for example, when you open LinkedIn and you see a job, the system basically looks
Yeah.
at your profile and says you have 9 out of the 10 skills, you're the top 5 percentile of
Matching.
applicants. So it's not a recruiting tool, but it's kind of a business tool. It's kind of a business analysis that it
Right.
does. So yes,
Exactly,
in
yeah.
future with technology, I wouldn't say it would make it more complicated, but you can't take the human element out of the entire process. I think that's a far cry at the moment.
Since you have such immense experience, can you talk about challenges that you face with hiring, sourcing, and how is your company managing to have a strong foothold in this hiring game overall?
So,
Or
good one. So there are two perspectives to it. I think hiring for your core is always going to be easy. I think that's a piece of cake. Like for example, if you're working with Citibank or any of the banks, hiring for a banking role,
Correct.
right? It's a
Correct.
no-brainer, right? Why would anyone kind of an investment banker say no to Citi unless he's got a competitive
Right.
offer? But that is a good problem to have. You're competing, right? For BASF, being a chemical engineer, it's a no-brainer. If you're in that field, that's an aspirational company to be. Where you kind of start really facing
Yes.
challenges and you really have to move is when you're hiring offbeat critical roles for those business. For example, I'll give you in BASF, you're hiring digital skill sets. Why would any technology guy, rather than looking at a TCS, Infosys, maybe Google's of the world, look at BASF? Right? How do you kind of first convince the guys that BASF is also a prospective in their consideration set? How do BASF, kind of make a place in their consideration set? From consideration set, you move it up, right? You kind of convert it into an offer, whether they join or not join is another thing. That is a place where, with a lot of digitization coming in, a lot of niche roles, and in future, the workforce will have diverse work roles, right? So, how do you kind of look at talent from allied industries or another industry? How do you pitch your company to that? That is going to be extremely important.
So, Sam, can you tell us about new generation of HR strategies, probably which you have seen or you think might be very relevant today or tomorrow? And what are the new working styles and few strategies which you believe are of utmost importance?
So I think employee connect is something that we are going back to roots on, right? I think there was a time of where we were with people, and then not all organizations, but some organizations, some of my friends that I know, kind of veered into the way that HR is the exclusive of only upper management, right? So as a business partner or a TA guy, you are seen only walking with the leaders, and you no more connect with the employees. And employees also, right? You kind of go through glass door through many companies, you will kind of hear that. You're like, the HR doesn't even know how many people are there. And now we are kind of
That's the
going
general norm.
correct. And they say that, are mera HR to, for my birthday lands up, but prior to that, I have not even seen who he is. Right? So it's a funny situation to be in. But I think now the fundamentals are getting back to connecting with employees. And I think this time around, when you say connect with employees, it's not for birthdays or anything. There are topics like career development, right? When we talk about topics like individual development plan, we say your career at an organization is the employee's responsibility, right? And HR and managers become coaches. Traditionally, what was the belief in the old school, this thing? You deliver, you give your blood to the organization, the manager or the organization will take care of you, right? Is that a proprietor kind of a mindset? But now things are changing, and it's your career. You want to create a healthy competition within the organization, help the employee explore paths within the organization, and make it a healthy environment. So this, while in paper, has always been there in situations like pandemic, right, where roles do become redundant, and that is the reality of the day. But you've also invested in your employees, and you don't want to let them go. They are high quality employees, right? You've spent time, energy, effort. They have learned and acquired skill sets with your organization. Now, how do you mobilize them for other roles? So I think that kind of getting back to roots, and that's one development that I'm really happy to see that we are all heading towards.
Great. Glad to know that. So I would like to tell you that like we as a student and lot of everybody who has taken up HR, we are do a lot of certification courses like SHRM and so on and so forth. And we believe very strongly, being as a student, that it will give us an upper hand in our corporate journey. So what I want to know, what exactly is your opinion on this? And
Okay.
would you advise students to go for it, or you would ask them to start with their journey and then see it goes?
Yes. So here I have a mixed opinion. To be very candid, I myself, at many times have registered but not paid to get myself certified, because I'm kind of caught up between two realities. Reality number one, there is enough number of people with formal degrees and certificates who are very theory in nature. I think most of the organizations at this time would want to look at people who are very practical, have the right attitude of attaining and getting the job done. I think everyone has enough of theory. right? And also this concept of mugging up, knowing everything by heart, maybe would have been of some use where we were not in the digital age, right? You didn't have a mobile phone at the edge of your
Right.
hand where you could just quickly search up something to get things right in order. But now in
Right,
that
right.
stage, getting yourself theoretically certified, right? There are certain certifications that are practical in nature, but most that I know of are theoretical in nature. So how does that add value? So today, as a recruiter, if I'm looking and I say you already are an MBA holder, which is good, it kind of certifies that there is an amount of theory in you that you're aware of. Getting an additional certification,
Correct.
how does that kind of help? Right? It's basically
Okay.
the same thing as a theory. That said, there are certain certifications that are required. Maybe after 5 years, 6 years, there are certain programs that certify your practical knowledge also. Like, say for example, if you're doing
Okay.
Six Sigma, right? So there is an amount of theory. Then there are also certain projects that you'll have to do to kind of complete your certification. Those kind of certification do still hold value, right? So there's no right or wrong to your certification program. There are multiple ones. You will have to take a deeper dive in it. Get yourself certified in things that are much more practical in nature. Theory, yes, they
Yes.
are there. Certain roles will require you to have theoretical knowledge, but I think graduating from good institutions like SCMHRD, I think we fairly cover a lot of topics. So my suggestion to most of the guys that I typically counsel would be wait 5 6 years, do your practicals, get into projects,
Okay.
and by then you'll even get to know, right, that these are the areas that you're actually interested in, and maybe certify in those rather than just kind of spreading wings across everything. That kind of helps you
Right.
have a higher value for your certification, because see, certification is not free. It involves your time, effort, and involves
Correct.
money, right? Yes. And
Yes.
in times like these, we have to be very wise where we kind of put our efforts. But at the end of the day, as a recruiter,
Right.
one thing goes without saying, certificate or not, what every company is looking in a person is the attitude. And attitude can never be certified,
Right.
right? So you can have 10
Right.
certifications, very glossy MBA, but if you don't have the right attitude, it's also no one's purpose. So invest time in building that, attitude. And it's predominantly through experience, exposure, experience, right?
Okay.
Pick up projects, raise your hand, and build yourself
Okay.
overall.
Okay. Thank you for this wonderful advice. I'm sure everybody at my end are going to definitely be very happy listening to this. Okay, moving ahead. So there is a lot of talk about diversity hiring, especially LGBTQ.
Yes.
Policies are in place at every company, and you have worked in manufacturing as well as finance sector, very different. So, which one, according to you, is much more prompt or better at having strong policies respect to diversity hiring?
So, here's my say on these, right? And I think diversity is a universal problem in the industry, and I don't see it to be per se a policy issue. I think every company has a policy, in terms of how you deal with,
Right.
diversity, what you should do, what you should not do. Two key things, when it comes to diversity, that I find we have not yet fully addressed is talent attraction, right? And second is talent retention. While you have the policies in place, which is like your hygiene
Okay.
work. Now, why do I say that?
Right.
We say, for example, as an organization, and I'm giving a hypothetical organization here, right? I'm not naming BSF or Citi, but I'm saying a hypothetical organization.
Okay.
I have my basics in place
Okay.
saying that I want to drive diversity, I want to increase this, blah, 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 blah. But when I go to the recruiting table and I'm
Okay.
looking at talent, I'm clearly saying and not acknowledging the break in a woman's career due to marriage, due to transfer, due to various life events. I'm failing to acknowledge, the
Correct.
fact that a woman's life is much more demanding. So we don't look at those, and the moment we see a gap, the moment we see the person's career has plateaued, it might be a conscious call of the woman to maybe in a phase of life saying that I don't want to accelerate,
Break.
not take a break. It says that I'm not going to go aggressively. It might mean a stagnation of 2 to 3 years in my current role, but my priorities are changing. The moment you kind of look at these, I think we don ourselves a superior hat and say the woman is not good enough or the applicant is not good enough because she's kind of taken a back seat. So how do I know she's going to drive my
Right.
this thing? So
Right.
practically, when you're looking over there, we have to coach our managers ourselves in terms of how we look at it. I do recollect attending one of the diversity seminars in Mumbai, and there was this beautiful word that was coined. It said motherhood penalty, right? So the biggest
Okay.
problem that women face is motherhood penalty. So the moment
I agree.
either you don't
Yeah.
want to hire because a woman because she becomes a mother, okay? And if she becomes a mother, then you don't want to hire the mother because she is a mother. She is more demanding in terms of time. She has a family to take care of, right? So, आगे कुआं पीछे खाई वाला सिचुएशन है. So, I think
Right.
having policy in one is one. Second is being very practical and open about it. So that's where we really need to keep continuing to put our efforts, in getting the right kind of managers to even recruit while your organization might have a
Right.
policy. The second
Right.
and equally important is retention. Now, your first job is done by getting the person on board. The second
Okay.
is also in an evolving situation like this, policies are not going to be whole and soul, right? Many organizations would say
Yes.
this is not there in our policy, right? While pandemic hit us very hard, yes, everyone were working from home, but the role of the woman has kind of now gone tenfold, even more complicated, right? So,
Correct. Yes.
anyone holding a policy or lying by a policy and not able to take the judgment call or risk is not doing justice to the whole concept of D&I, right? So, you need to have
Okay.
a bit more humane approach. Yes, I wouldn't say give special allowances to women and not men, but I think the pandemic in certain companies has also taught us, men or women, we all have family. Right, and the role of
Right,
caregiver
right.
is no more restricted to a man or a woman. Now that men have worked from home and have faced the hardships, I think men are more appreciative of the fact of what a woman also kind of dons as multiple hats. So I think the acceptance
That is
has
the silver lining.
silver lining. So you have to be optimist. Yes, pandemic
Yeah.
is a difficult time for all of us. But as evolution has taught us, right, the survival of the fittest, and during pandemic we make significant leaps in terms of progress. So you take that, and I think this pandemic has taught all of us a lot of things.
Right. So more inclusivity in behavior than policies is, I think,
Yes,
is going to be the need at
yes.
the hour.
It's more inclusivity and acceptance of that philosophy by your
I
employees.
understand. Yes. Amazing answer. Okay, so coming to our last question, so you would know that our current batch is very different. Like we have never gone through such circumstances
Correct.
that we are going through, and we doing everything digitally. So one message you would want to give them, one.
So I myself kind of empathize and sympathize with this batch, not for good or bad, but one kind of coincidence is that I graduated my degree in 2008, and that was during
Okay.
the crisis. Economic crisis, right? Where jobs were very less, people were losing out. You had companies throwing out people in hordes, and you really were scared for a job, right? And maybe at that was a time where
You
I,
have seen it then.
yes, and I was not prepared for that at all because prior to that, I was like very clear, boss, I'm kind of going to do a job. I don't want to do a master, so I didn't even enroll for CAT or SNAP or anything. I was very clear, okay, yeah, boss, I'm going to take a job and enjoy my life thereon. But I kind of evolved at that time when the last year came. Maybe I took had to take a year break, prep myself up for the subsequent year, and then took up masters. One thing
Okay.
that I can only say to anyone, not only the incoming batch or the outgoing batch, but also the incoming batch, and otherwise everyone in general, you have to be optimistic. In every issue, you have to see a silver lining, right? While on the short run, yes, there will be problems. Nobody's taking that away from you. People might have educational loans, might have financial
अगेन
stress, but that cannot get the better out
यस
of you, right? These are
अग्री
challenges. Today, say for example, today even I am in the same situation as much as you guys are. So there is no job security right now. So if you don't have a job that you're going to get out of placements, I don't know today if my job is going to exist 3 months down the lane due to the pandemic. So all of us are into it together. So we can't let this situation get the best of us. Keep learning. I think even during such kind of situation, what companies do look out and what everyone appreciates is you constantly learning, right? And it need and constantly putting your work to practice. It might not be for pay, right? You might not have the best of
Right.
companies coming in, or you might not even get a company for the fact. But what you do in these kind of times, in troubled times, how you react to the situation is something that you can brag about for the rest of your life, right?
Yes, yes.
If you can survive this, then for a company, when they are rolling and doing good, then you're an asset. I think the best out of rather the worst out of a person comes when they are through going through their worst, and that worst should be our best. That should be our motto or our perspective. So be optimistic.
Yes, very.
There is no single line solution or an answer that I can give to people passing out. It is a tough environment.
Agree.
The only thing we can be is be optimistic. There will be many opportunities. Like for example, I just recently came across one of my friend who said that boss, my business is going fairly well, but I don't have a formal HR guy. So I said that
Okay.
fair enough. So why can't I help you? I'm not looking for a money. You don't have to hire an HR, but at least that gives me an opportunity to maybe do something different for you, right?
Right,
Similarly,
correct,
you guys
correct.
can also kind of reach out, check out on opportunities, keep an eye out. I think now the economy is much more open. We have this some thing called gig economy, freelancer.com. You can do short-term
Right,
projects. Don't expect money out of it,
right,
right? In
right.
entire thing. But your learning experience that you do right now or have right now is something that you will get that will get you a long way ahead.
Right. Okay. So, Sam, some really great answer, really great insights, especially about the courses and the diversity thing. Very, very well said. And thank you so much for coming and recording this session with
Thank
us.
you,
It was
Shruti.
so insightful.
Same here. The pleasure is always,
Thanks.
it's always nice to kind of come back and connect with your campus and also, the students. Wishing all of you all the very best. I know it's a tough year, but I'm sure things will improve as it always has in the world. And we've survived. One of the comment I heard from one of the leader when, everyone were down is that as humanity, we've survived, meteors, we've survived two great world wars, the great famine, plagues, everything, right? So we will survive this. It is just a matter of time. In this time, we will have some hardships, but that's what builds human humanity and human race, right? So take it in your stride, and I'm sure and wish everything gets back well and rather even better this year.
Amazing, amazing. Thank you, Sam. Thank you so much for taking out
Thank you,
time.
Shruti. Appreciate it.